Good morning. Our program will start in 5 minutes. Please take your seats. Thank you. Good morning. Our program will start in 2 minutes. Please take your seats. Thank you.
boat.
I feel the need for speed.
Roads, where we're going, we don't need roads.
He's looking at you, kid.
I am the father.
I'm Batman.
I'm Spartacus.
Bond. James Bond.
Goonies never say die.
You're killing me, Smalls.
I see dead people.
Life was like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get.
That little pig.
Houston, we have a problem.
Wax on, hat. Wax off.
Show me the money. Show me the money. Show me the money.
The snozzberries taste like snozzberry.
I'll be back. I'll be back. I'll be back.
Here's Johnny.
You can't handle the truth.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home. There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
Welcome to the stage, Itron's Vice President of Global Marketing and Public Affairs, Sharelynn Moore.
This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove that my life song. My power's coming.
Welcome. Welcome to Itron Utility Week 2015, and welcome to a week of resourceful innovation. I'm Sharelynn Moore, and once again, I'm honored to be your hostess and your MC for the week. We have an incredible program in store, and we're pretty excited to get right into it. But before we do, welcome to sunny and beautiful and very warm Los Angeles. In Itron's 33 years of hosting Itron customer conferences, this is our first year in Los Angeles and our first year in this urban, incredible venue. So I hope you're going to love it as much as we are. So with that, we actually have a special guest here with us today that would like to give us a very special local Los Angeles welcome. Here with us today, we have the president of the Los Angeles City Council, Herb Wesson. Herb, will you join me on stage? On July 21st, 2015, Los Angeles City Council Memberman Herb Wesson was unanimously re-elected as Council President. Wesson has held this leadership position since 2012. He is the first African American Council President in city history.
Yes, I am.
Throughout his career, he's been president. President Wesson is well known for his uncanny ability to bring people together. So let's give President Wesson a warm welcome.
Thank you. Good morning. Give her a round of applause. Your nice, cheery, infectious smile Welcome to Los Angeles, greatest city on the planet. We hope that you have a great time. I mean, think about it. You're here for Itron Utility Week, right? Itron. Sounds like an Avenger movie. I wonder if you guys are going to have like a Captain America run across the stage or something. Look, we in Los Angeles care about you. We want to make sure that not only do you have a phenomenal conference, but that you have a phenomenal time when you're here in our great city. And while I'm here, I do want to acknowledge we do have a bunch or some of our DWP workers who are the best in the United States of America and abroad. Give LA DWP a round of applause. Now, did you guys bring your own water? If you run out, I know a guy. Spend your money. A lot of it. We have great food. We have great people. We have great entertainment. We're the greatest city on the planet. Welcome to Hollywood, where dreams come true. God bless you all. Welcome to LA. Have a great conference. Avenger.
Thank you for that warm welcome, President Wesson. We appreciated that. All right, well, this week's theme is all about resourceful innovation. It's the reason we're here. How can we use our systems? How can we optimize them to be more effective? How can we evaluate new technology and see how we can bring that into our utilities? How can we become better equipped or better trained to provide value back at our workplace? Can we make new connections and learn from each other? And maybe most importantly, let's have a heck of a great time doing it. Sound good? Let's do it. I don't know about you, but when I talk about being in the utility industry, I don't always have the impression that we're viewed as the most innovative industry. But you know what? I know different, and you know different. We are innovative, and we do incredible things every day. So I'm going to cover just a few of the innovations that we've seen this last year, and again, it's just a sampling of some to showcase how innovative we really are. Our first story, we don't need to go very far. It's Southern California Edison operating around this Los Angeles area. SoCal Edison is operating a 5 million meter openway system. This summer, they were facing numerous consecutive scorching hot 100 degree plus days. They used the openway network to engage a Save Power Days program to support a Save Power Days program in which they engaged consumers. They have more than 400,000 consumers participating, engaged them with smart thermostats, emails, smartphones, and on peak days, ask them to save energy over and above what they normally would. Consumers are saving, and they've seen a significant shave and off and peak reduction during the summer, upwards of 30 megawatts. Congratulations, SCE. That is innovative. Another example is we cross the country over to the city of North Miami Beach. The city of North Miami Beach is installing a water fixed network solution, as well as 11,000 leak detector sensors, acoustical leak detection devices. I believe they're only halfway done with their installation, but they've already been able to predict and repair significant size leaks in their systems, saving on an annual basis with those leaks so far of 27 million gallons of water. That's an incredible amount of savings already. We look forward to tracking your progress, North Miami Beach, as you continue your installation. Now let's talk about Allegasco, a gas company in Alabama. They have 470,000 gas meters deployed with our 100G gas ERT technology. They use Itron's mobile collection systems, our field collection system software, the installation and field tool called Field Deployment Manager that manages work orders. And they use this system very effectively for meter to cash, very reliably. But what's quite innovative is they're using that system beyond meter reading, beyond billing, and they're using it in some pretty innovative ways. They fully optimize this system. Every time they go out in the field, they're collecting GIS lat long information as part of that work order. They're collecting meter diagnostic information, as well as data logging information with the granular usage at that meter. They're bringing that information in, and they're not keeping it in an ancillary system just in case, but they're bringing that information in and they're using it across their utility when they need it, where they need it. In the cases of storms and unfortunately tornado conditions that they've seen, they've been much more easily able to predict where their gas meters are, what's on and what's off, and when gas is restored, they can notify their customers much more seamlessly and quickly. Over on an annual basis, they've removed more than 12,000 truck rolls from having to go out and visit meters for billing-related issues, as well as, I think Brad Anderson was just telling me, he works for Alagasco, that last month they only estimated 2 meters. That's resourceful. Thank you, Alagasco. Our next story is about National Grid. National Grid is deploying a smart grid openway pilot in the Worcester, Mass area. They have more than 11,000 customers in this pilot, and they're engaging them in a variety of ways using various tools and technologies. These consumers, more than half of them, are significantly saving energy and saving money. The results of this pilot is going into a broader grid modernization plan that they're going to work with, their state on. Well, that's innovative in itself. One of the stories that particularly caught our attention is what they're doing with Habitat for Humanity. This National Grid team here pictured has partnered with Habitat to build a home. They're building a home for a wounded veteran, and they're not only building him a home, but they've equipped the home with smart Itron technology. It's able to do net metering. They've done a deep energy retrofit, and they've installed renewable energy sources. So this home that they've built is completely energy efficient, as well as a wonderful home for a wounded veteran. Thank you to National Grid. Way to walk the walk and talk the talk. Thank you. Our next story is in San Diego. Sempra and the gas company there is being asked by the California Public Utility Commission, as are all gas utilities in California, to look at pipeline safety. Sempra is taking an approach to evaluate the latest technologies available to monitor and maintain their pipeline. They're working with Itron to look at sensors that can measure or monitor methane sensing, pressure, leak, and vibration. They're bringing this information back to a central place where they can analyze this information to determine how to improve pipeline safety. The results of this plan will go back to the commission, and we'll look forward to seeing what comes out of it and are pleased to support them in this effort. Way to go, Sempra. Our next story, it comes from here in California regarding water. I think any of us, when we think about water scarcity issues, we saw the headlines about California and the drought conditions this summer. An interesting story is Rancho, California. They're using Itron's water fixed network technology to engage their end residential consumers in water conservation. They've deployed the system, and they've used that information on that daily usage information, or that detailed energy or water usage information, married that with weather data and landscape information, and created a My Water Tracker application. This application, they're seeing great results from it. Consumers are conserving water. They were at 22% reduction in May. They ramped up conservation to over 30 and 40% later throughout the summer. So they're really making a difference in a place where water is so scarce and the resource is so precious. Way to go, Rancho, California. While we've seen some incredible innovations for our utility customers, it's also Itron's job to listen to you. That's one of the reasons that we're here, that we can take the feedback that we get from you and evaluate what we need to do to iterate things on our side, make things better, build new products, develop new services. So we've been busy this last year looking at new innovations as well, based on feedback from you and the new technology that's available on the horizon. One of the first innovations is what we're doing around AMI deployments. We understand that deploying an AMI system can be costly. We understand it can be complex, and we also understand in working with you that you can see it as risky. We believe that by helping utilities and taking the opportunity to take Itron expertise, leverage our buying power to drive down the cost of the hardware and the software that's involved in the process, that we can offer the ability to operate, run, and maintain these systems for you. Through Itron Total Services, we have more than 250 utilities relying on Itron to operate systems on your behalf. One of the ways that we've been innovating is that we've looked at some of the more sophisticated software tools that are required to run these complicated systems, some of the more complicated systems. One of the tools is called Secure Network Infrastructure. It's an application that can cost upwards of $200,000 to operate and to install. While it wasn't designed to be able to run across many utilities in the cloud, in Itron's data center, we figured out how to take that system and share it across utilities, where we can directly pass those savings back out to you. That lowers the cost and complexity of running an AMI system, and we're committed to continuously innovating and finding ways to lower the cost, lower the complexity, and make it more accessible for all utilities. Our next story is around building smarter cities. Itron's been involved with smart cities from the get-go. We were a founding member of the Smart Cities Collaborative. We've won awards from Frost and Sullivan for our work here. And if you've been to a smart city event or see or saw a smart city event going on this year, Itron was involved, we participated, we partnered, and we sponsored. We truly believe and we see the potential that you as utilities have to be the leaders in your local communities and jumpstart and lead these efforts. These programs, these smart city programs, can provide economic development value back in your local communities, enrich your communities, and provide new services. We've seen that model work. If you look at Duke Energy, they were the visionary and the pioneer that jump-started Envision Charlotte in Charlotte. Now you see Envision Charlotte Herald as the hallmark most successful smart city installation in the US. In fact, on September 14th, the White House announced an Envision America program where they want to provide the resources and support to replicate Envision Charlotte's success in 10 other communities. Applications are open, and if we're not working with you already, come see us. We've got Envision America information available in our Knowledge Center. We have Amy Ossaker, the head of Envision Charlotte, also here. She'll be speaking at our Big Picture Smart City session. We'd love to work with you and support you as we have Envision Charlotte. Next, this innovation is particularly incredibly exciting and game-changing for us at Itron. We are launching Openway Riva. Openway Riva is our next generation communications platform that will run across electricity, gas, and water, and city applications. Openway Riva marries our proven Openway network platform built on IPv6 standards on top of Cisco technology with Itron Riva, our next generation communications technology. Openway Riva delivers new communication capabilities, including adaptive communications, where line devices can choose between power line carrier or various modulations or modes of RF. Battery devices can choose between various modes of RF, choosing and optimizing its best path. Openway Riva also brings computing, embedded computing, and application power at every device, sensor, meter, and node on the network. This means you can run applications, you have better awareness, you can coordinate and control in a way and make decisions in a way we've never been able to before. Also, OpenWay Riva opens up a new developers community, inviting developers to build new applications that can run on these endpoints and these nodes to solve new problems and to do things we can't even imagine yet. OpenWay Riva really is the future for all of us in automation and providing new next generation capabilities for our utilities and beyond into our communities. We are keenly aware that we've worked with many of you over the years to deploy current technology. We've considered that and we have opportunities and we want to work with you on migrating and coexisting to this new future. Come see us in the electricity, gas, or water sections of the Knowledge Center. There's sessions going on. Our CTO is speaking later today. We have sessions about IPv6 and gas and water as well. We'd love to work with you and plan this future together. With that, I'd like to turn the show over to someone else, but I just wanted to share a few of the innovations that we've seen in this community with our utilities from Itron, and more importantly, tee up that that's what we'll be doing the rest of this week is uncovering new innovations. So with that, I'd like to turn this over to Itron's President and CEO, Philip Mezey.
Everybody got somebody to lean on. Put your body next to mine.
Good morning, everyone. We are thrilled to be here with you once again. This is a highlight for us during the year. We get to spend time with our customers. It reminds us why it is that we work so hard at the efficient use of electricity, gas, and water. It gives us an incredible opportunity, as Sharelynn mentioned, to listen to you, to listen to what's changing in your business, to listen to the needs of your business, the challenges that you see on the horizon. All of those are really important, so please talk to our team about those things. It also gives us the opportunity to hear about areas where we've done well and not so well. And it's really important that when we have fallen short of your expectations, that you share that with us because we are absolutely committed to improving. Along those lines, I very briefly want to talk about a tough topic. How many of you are from water utilities or water customers? A pretty significant number of you. In the second quarter of this year, we had a product recall of 800,000 water endpoints. We had a 1 cent transistor that failed in these products. We discovered it as quickly as we knew how and got out there in the field. We are absolutely committed to replacing all of these products. And I say this to you because as a CEO, it's very important in these times when you're reading headlines about defects in products. I want to say I am personally responsible for this, and I am absolutely committed, as is Itron, to focusing on quality, to rectifying problems, and to understanding the impact that our problems have on your business. We are going to do everything that we can to prevent a recurrence of a problem like that. So before I get into talking to you about resourceful innovation, I have an admission to make. I am a native Californian. Here I am idealistically graduating from high school, in which I believed, and by the way, the story about California is that I recognize California is not the real world. Worse than that, I actually came from San Francisco, which is really not the real world, believe me. And when I graduated from, oh, wait for it, Berkeley, so really not the real world, I thought that thinking good thoughts and reading interesting books and things were going to change the world. And an interesting thing happens as you grow older, which is that you become a business person and you realize that really follow the money is a pretty important concept. So somewhere in my education along the way, I learned a really important thing, which is that powerful change comes at the intersection of policy, so good thinking, technology, which is something that we're very focused on, and good economics. Those things have to come together in order to create effective change. So let me give you a couple of examples about why I think this is a powerful concept and why it applies to what we're doing here today and tomorrow. I think many of you remember a front page headline, California outlaws the incandescent light bulb, and you're rolling your eyes saying, oh, come on, please. It turns out that the federal government actually had mandated an improvement in lighting efficiency, and California just got a little in front of that to sort of push the rest of the country. People were saying, you know, isn't this just a nanny state? What's going on here? What was really going on behind the scenes, and I'll just explain this graph in a second. On the left-hand side, you see lighting efficiency. That gray line down at the bottom is an incandescent light bulb, the number of watts it takes to produce a certain number of lumens. The green line is LEDs. So what's happening here is that technology and innovation are driving this huge increase in lumen per watt output. LEDs are an extraordinary innovation in the lighting space. Of course, lighting represents up to 20% of electric load. This is having an impact on a number of our customers who don't see an overall increase in their electric load because of things like energy efficiency and lighting. So you'd say, okay, well, that's great. Lighting efficiency has improved, but they cost too much. So here's where a signal from a policymaker is important. The industry invests heavily in lighting, and the graph on the right shows you the cost of LED lighting, which has fallen dramatically. It isn't policy that's going to make the incandescent light bulb obsolete. It's economics. It's the graph that you see on the right that simply says a better product at a better price is going to drive a much better outcome. So, not policy. Let's look at some trash for a minute. When I was a kid in Berkeley, San Francisco, recycling was for hippies. You saved up your recycling, you took it to a recycling center. I mean, you had to really be committed in order to recycle. These days, there's a huge amount of recycling. There was a little policy innovation that took place. Legislatures passed a 1 cent or a 5 cent deposit on cans and bottles, and it got people thinking, hey, there's money in the trash. And believe it or not, since then, the recycling industry in North America has grown to a $67 billion a year industry. We still have more to go. On the left-hand side, we still are throwing $600 million worth of aluminum cans into the trash. That's really a shame, because when we recycle aluminum cans, we recover 95% of the energy that it took in order to make those cans. That energy that we save when we recycle is actually enough to power a city. Just 1 year's worth is enough to power a city like Pittsburgh for 10 years. So recycling, it's a big business, wasn't really driven by policy. I mean, there have been policies to support it, like the deposit, but what really changed is when people figured out that there was a huge amount of money in the recycling business and in trash, and adoption rates have skyrocketed as a result. I want to give a water example, because water is so important to us. Just a funny story, none of us ever thought we'd put a toilet up in a presentation. But the humble innovation of the low flush toilet, this is a 1.5 gallon flush toilet, costs a little bit more up front. Turns out, can save you, as you see, a very, very significant amount of water. This has been a huge source of innovation in the water space. Very, very humble thing. Low cost, low flow shower head, kind of a nuisance to have to stand around and shift from right to left to take a shower. For a family of four in an average year, saves you 20,000 gallons of water. Did I mention that water is the largest energy user in the state of California? 20-30% of energy in California is used for the pumping purification of water. When we use these very humble innovations, it has a huge impact on the water supply and on the energy supply. And lastly, gray water. This is an example from Orlando, Florida. 7,000 homes and businesses are actually now getting water, recycled water. The United States really lags in this. Less than 1% of our gray water is recycled. There are other countries where that's significantly higher. We're going to see an uptick in that area. People are going to figure out that it's easier to recycle water than it is to purify water, and it's going to drive more adoption in this area. So on into the utility space in our space. Big controversy right now, EPA has released the Clean Power Plan. For those of you who didn't see it, the Clean Power Plan is advocating that we, is demanding actually, that we reduce CO2 emissions 30% from the levels they were at in 2005. Now, I don't want to get into whether or not this is good policy or bad policy. It's something, though, that we have to deal with. Climate change is, you know, a very hot topic. But I want to say that, okay, so you start out at the policy level here. what's really going on under the covers, because many people are calling this a political war on coal. What I'd like to say is that this isn't a war on coal. This is economic speaking. This graph shows you, that yellow line actually shows you the cost of produced natural gas. What's happening is, through tremendous technological innovation in hydraulic fracking, horizontal drilling, exploration, transportation, a number of other areas where significant investments have been made over decades, the cost of natural gas has come down so significantly that it is now more economically competitive than coal. Since 2003, 12 coal companies have declared bankruptcy. So people are focusing on policy. The real battle is being fought down here at the economic level. And this is a really interesting graph because we're going to see this battle continue to go on. Many of you are going to be talking about the impact of renewables on your grid. Well, I'd suggest that the ultimate impact of renewables is a story that has to be told on a graph like this, which is the economics of renewables have to improve significantly in order for them to be cost competitive. There's only so far that policy is going to go in this adoption. SolarCity just announced a new panel that they plan to manufacture in the United States. Good on them. They claim it is 40% more efficient than the prior panel at a lower cost. So let's hope that the curve, like we saw on the LED slide, continues on the renewable energy slide, and that we're going to see a line growing underneath natural gas that drives down the cost of producing renewable energy, and we're going to see a battle there. Okay, that's interesting. What does it have to do with the people in this room? The best line that we could see on this chart is the cost of efficiency, the power we don't use, the waste that we capture because we harness technology to capture the most precious thing that we have, which is waste. Because the cost of capturing inefficiency should be lower than all of these sources. And it turns out that the Clean Power Plan, whatever flaws it may have, does put emphasis on efficiency as a way of creating carbon offsets. And we have a great source of efficiency to talk about. I actually mentioned it last year, 5 to 7% of electricity, 1 to 3% of gas, up to 30% of water leak or are wasted out of our distribution systems alone. This is good stuff. This is a problem, but it's also a tremendous opportunity for the people in this room. Because it turns out that we have the technology today, and you have deployed, in many cases, the technology you need today to start working down this problem. How do we go beyond using the meter as a cash register for billing purposes? How do we go beyond defining your job as being part of customer service or revenue cycle to start look at the impact that this data can have on tackling this huge problem that we have in efficiency? Because when we start capturing $1 billion, $2 billion, $3 billion of waste by using the data that we're generating from the systems, by putting out endpoints that are able to sense where leaks are occurring, by putting sensors out to tell us methane's leaking out of pipes, by looking at voltage imbalances and connectivity problems, we're not only going to increase customer service and improve the reliability of our systems, we're going to attack a fundamental economic point here. We're going to make our systems more efficient. And let me put a bigger context on this discussion about efficiency. And again, this is something I showed you last year. In the last 30 years, what this chart shows you is we have halved the amount of energy required to produce one unit of GDP. So let me find another way to say that isn't so wonky. We've become twice as energy efficient economically. It takes half as much energy to make one unit of GDP. Why is that important? It makes the United States economy more efficient, more vibrant, and more competitive. This is a story of economic vitality. Efficiency isn't just about saving money. Efficiency is about creating viable economies and creating jobs and creating economic competitive advantage. And we've been very successful at this for the past 30 years. So huge progress has been made here. What is it that we can do in the next 30 years in order to keep this story going? If we're able to do this, great things are going to happen to our economy. So, as I said, we've already got a bunch of the building blocks for doing this. Sharelynn mentioned this. We've got now an integrated system, one network that can combine electricity, gas, and water. So we can efficiently collect more data than ever before, not just for billing purposes, but to really reach into how it is that we can optimize the delivery of electricity, gas, and water, and how we can help our customers to optimize the use of their electricity, gas, and water. Huge opportunity there, and we're not stopping there. We're reaching to the next level, this discussion about smart cities, of what other types of devices could use this network. What other kind of data could be collected across this network that would allow us to generate really new insights to drive efficiency even further? The technology is here. The policy is out there. Let's work on the economics. But you all have a jump on the economics because you've been able to put this technology out in the field. Some of it has been there for some time, but we have the opportunity to continue to refresh that technology, supported by a very specific business case that gives us a tremendous upside to continue to drive innovation and efficiency, to improve your business, to make it more competitive. As we talk about disruptors of the utility business model, the best insurance we've got for your company is that we continue to pay attention to improving efficiency, service, and reliability. And the technology that we're going to talk about over the next 2 days, we feel helps you to do that. So, in closing, let's think about the future. We're going to have Daniel Burris up here in a moment really talk to us, one of the world's great futurists, talk to us about hard and soft trends. I feel confident standing here telling you that one of the hard trends that we're going to see is that in a future world, efficiency is going to be taken for granted. Why do I think that? You don't smoke on airplanes anymore. You don't throw aluminum cans on the beach. 10 years from now, seeing an incandescent light bulb is going to be the exception rather than the rule. These things are written. I think 10 or 20 years from now, our children are going to say, you used to waste what? 30% of your, huh? How did that work? We have technology to run our system so much more efficiently. It's an exciting problem. I wake up in the morning thrilled to be able to work on this problem and thrilled to be able to work with you in order to solve these types of problems. Let's use the next 2 days to explore how it is that we can work together to get even a small amount of this efficiency improvement and also to hear from you about where those opportunities exist and how we can do a better job of collaborating in order to make that happen. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful conference.